So you've explored a bunch of different ideas. You wrote a bunch of different stuff. How did Libricks come about?
It basically came to me that it had to be kind of a grassroots movement, and it had to be something that changed culturally, and it had to be relatively personal. People meeting people, people finding out that no, I'm not the only one on campus who feels this way. I feel alone, and there are a lot of other people who feel alone. I believe this thing, and it's not as unpopular as I thought. You know, the basically creating heterodoxy of thought, and it's creating that moment where you realize that your politics are personal and that your politics are shared by a lot of people on campus. And so I just started coding it. I didn't have much coding experience, but went headfirst in and figured how hard could it be, you know?
I mean, this is really fascinating. So I talked to a lot of software engineers, AI people. Obviously, that's where my passion, my like interests are, my focus has been throughout my life. The fascinating thing about your story, I think it should be truly inspiring to like people that want to change the world, is that you don't have a background in programming. You don't have even maybe a technical background. So you saw a problem. You explored different ideas, and then you just decided you're going to learn how to build an app, like without a technical background. Like you didn't try to. I mean, that's so bold. That is so beautiful, man. Can you take me through the journey of deciding to do that, of like learning to program without a programming background and building the app? Like detailed. Like, what do you actually like? How do you start?
Sure. I mean, you want to buy a Mac. I learned, and you had to buy a Mac. I'm just gonna go step by step, right? I'll be as dumb as possible because it was truly, you know, like leading by your feet.
So you need a computer for this.
Well, yeah, I had a PC at the time, and I was Android at the time, and I realized, you know, I realized it should be like an iOS app, and so, yeah, that was a decision. But you know, I knew kids these days, they're always on their phone, and you know, I wanted you to be able to say a passing thought, you know, in class, make a passing, like you're walking around and you have a thought and you can express it, or you're in the dining hall and you have your phone out, you can express it. So it was clear to me it should be an iOS app.
By the way,
Yeah.
Android is great. You should definitely check out.
We also are now available on Android, but we'll get there for the you Android users from MIT, Stanford, or the Ivy League. So back to how it happened. So I realized I need a Mac. So went out and got a Mac. And I realized I need an iPhone for testing eventually. Got an iPhone. So those were the real robot blocks to start with. From there, I mean, there's almost too much information out there about programming. The question is like, where do you start and what's going to be useful to you? And my first thought was I should look at some Yale classes, but it became very clear very quickly that that was not the right place to start. That would probably be the right place to start if I wanted to get a job at Amazon, but my goal was slightly different. And I definitely had it in mind that what I was trying to make was I'm trying to prove out an idea. I'm not trying to make a finished product. I'm just trying to get to the first step, because I figured if I keep getting to the next step, at least I won't die now, you know? Like at least things will move forward. I'll learn new things. Maybe I'll meet new people. I'll show a degree of seriousness about what I'm doing, and things will come together. And that is, as you'll see, what ends up happening. So I start with Swift, right? And I find this video from the Stanford professor that had like a million views that was like how to make basically Swift apps. Like perfect.
And you just like, so you got this Mac and you what, like go to google.com and you type in
Download Xcode. And then,
Xcode.
yeah, and then I type in on YouTube like Stanford iOS Swift. Enter. First YouTube video has a million views. I'm like, it has to be good at Stanford, has a million views. I got lucky. I mean, that turned out to be a very good video.
And it's basically like introductory course to Swift.
Yeah, I mean, you say introductory. I think most of the people in that class probably had a much better background than I
They're
did. And
software developers, probably. They're like computer scientists.
it was slow for me. I don't think I realized it fully at the time, just how far behind I was from the rest of the class, because I was like, wow, seems like people are picking this up really quickly. So it took a little longer, and you know, a lot of time on Stack Overflow, but eventually I made a truly minimal viable product, the most minimal. Like we're talking, you know, put text on screen, add text to screen, comment on top of text, you know, make a post, make a response. And anyone with a Yale email can do this, and you plug it into a cloud server, and you verify people's accounts, and you're off. You
have to figure out how to, like, the whole idea of, like, having an account. So there's a permanence. Like, you can create an account with an email.
Verify it.
Okay. So that's not, you know.
And that's literally how I thought about it, right? Like, so what do I need to do? And I'm like, well, the first thing I need is a login page.
Yeah.
And I'm like, how to make a login page in Swift? Yeah. I mean, it's that easy. If someone, this has been done before, of course.
And then the first page that pops up was probably a pretty damn good page when you
Google it. Wasn't that bad. It wasn't perfect, but, like, maybe it got me 80% of the way there.
Yeah.
And then I came into some bugs. And then, you know, I asked Stack Overflow a few questions. And then I got a little further, and then I found some more bugs. And then I'm like, maybe this isn't the right way to do it. Maybe I should do it this way. And
yeah,
I'm sure my code isn't great, but the goal isn't to make great code. The goal wasn't to make scalable code. It was to understand, is this something my friends will use? Like, what is the reaction going to be if I put it in their hands? And am I capable of making this thing?
And that's awesome. And so you're just focusing on the experience, like actually just really driving towards that first step. Figuring out the first step and really driving towards it. Of course, you have to also figure out, like, concept of, like, storage, like database.
You know something funny?
What's that?
I just made the database structure with no knowledge of databases whatsoever. And I start showing it to my friends who have an experience in CS, and they're like, you used a heap. That's so interesting. Or like, yeah. Why did you decide to store it in this way? I'm like, bro, I don't even know what a heap is.
Yeah.
I just did it because it works. Like, I'm trying to make calls and stuff, and they're like, they're like, the hierarchy is really, like, and I'm like, what?
Well, there's a deep, profound lesson in there that I don't know how much you've interacted with computer science people since, but they tend to optimize and have these kind of discussions, and what results is over-optimization. It's like worrying, is this really the right way to do it? And then you go, as opposed to doing the first thing on Stack Overflow, you go down this, like, rabbit hole of what's the actual proper way to do it. And then you're like, you wake up 5 years later working at Amazon because you've never finished the login page. Like, it's kind of hilarious, but that's a really deep lesson. Like, just get it done. And there's like, what's a heap, bro? is the right, that should be a t-shirt. That's really the right approach to building something that ultimately creates an experience, and then you iterate eventually. That's how some of the greatest software products in this world have been built, is you create it quickly and then just iterate. What was, by the way, in your mind, the thing that you were chasing as a prototype? Like, what was the first step that it feels like something is working? Like, is it you interacting with another friend?
Yeah, I think the first step was like, it's one thing to tell someone about an idea, but it's another thing to put in their hands and kind of see, like, the way their eyes kind of look.
Yeah.
And when I'd walk around cross campus, which is part of Yale, and I'd literally just go up to people and run up to them and be like, try this. You got to try this. This is pre-quarantine, by the way, of course. Yeah, this would never be the same post-quarantine, but I'm like, you got to try this. Like, what is it? And I'd be like, and I'd explain, it's like an anonymous discussion feed for our Yale campus.
Yeah.
And you'd see their gears turning, and they just, some people would be like, not interested.
Yeah.
I'm like, fine, not your target demographic. I get it. You'll come eventually. But some people, like, you could see it. They got it. They're like, yes. And that's when I was like, okay, there is, and you don't need 50% of people to like it.
Yeah.
You need what? 5%, 10% to love it. And then they'll tell 5%, 10%.
Yeah. Word of mouth. Yeah.
And you're good. Of course, the first version was very, very crappy, but seeing people trying despite all the crappiness was sort of enough to be the first step. And, you know, since then, all of my code's been stripped out. I now have friends who basically have told me, don't bother with the coding part. Yeah. You do the rest. You just make sure that we can code, because they want to code. Great. I mean, I'm not an engineer.
Yeah.
I never intended to be an engineer, and there's a lot to do that's not engineering.
Yes.
But the point was just to validate the idea, so to speak.